go in here?
I can get her to move over one.
Blesses us with gifts of love in relationships that bring joy and gratitude. God protects us in times of danger and guards us from the time of trial.
Thanks.
Let us pray. God of all creation, in this season of harvest, Thanksgiving, we are struck by the beauties of autumn, leaves in bright colors, birds flying south in formation, fields ripe with produce. Such beauty speaks to your goodness that provides what each beloved creature needs. On this Thanksgiving weekend, renew our gratitude for what you give to us in the fruitfulness of creation and in Jesus Christ, who teaches us how to walk wisely on the earth you made. For all your good gifts, we honor you with thanks and praise, now and always. invite you to be seated. On such a beautiful morning, I invite you to take a moment and reflect upon anything that is keeping you from entering God's gates with praise and thanksgiving. Loving God, we find it difficult to trust the promise of your overflowing goodness and mercy. We're always worried about running out of things, money, energy, health, compassion, time. The world that we live in is fueled with anxiety and the fear of scarcity. It shapes who we are as individuals and who we are as a church. We confess that we forget that you are indeed God unfailing, unresting, undiminished, and undiscouraged. Forgive us. Help us turn our hearts to you so that we may find the abundance of life that you alone can give. Hear our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Dear friends, be at peace this day. Jesus, our high priest, knows the temptations of the human heart. From the throne of grace, he offers us mercy in our weakness, to renew us in our faithfulness. Thanks be to God. As we pray together, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you all this day. Take a moment and greet each other.
Welcome and happy Thanksgiving. Today we have a lot of announcements. Here we are, pop up. Thanksgiving Messy Church, Thursday, October 17th at 5. PCW meets on Thursday, October 15th. And here's all the numbers. Soup luncheon again on October 26th, 11:30 to 1. Talk to Barbara or Adeline if you can help. And the roast beef dinner on November 16th. Details are coming. And that's it. Have a great weekend.
I'll use my position to put a plug in for Thursday night's Messy Church. So if you're interested in joining us, please speak to me. It's a fun time for folks of all ages, and we'll do some reflecting and thinking about Thanksgiving and share some food together. So if you happen to be free. Hey, my little saints, I see a few of you out there. Want to come and join me? You're going to come first. Awesome. Awesome. Good morning. Who's that fellow? Do you know that fellow? That's Fergie. Yeah. Good. Well.
Do you know what tomorrow is?
Tomorrow's Thanksgiving. Yeah. So this is called Fergie Counts His Blessings. Let's give a listen. That's not fair. I'm going to run away from home so I can do what I want and be my own frog. Have you ever thought that? I did. And my father said, sure, what can I pack you? We'll talk about that later. Spring break was not working out too well for Fergie the Frog. He had failed a math test the week before, so his teachers sent his work home with him to do on the holidays. Miss Webfoot doesn't understand, Fergie complained to his father as he helped paint the house. Nobody does the times table at Frog Scout Camp. Then there won't be any Frog Scout Camp for you, Father Frog said firmly. You have to learn your math. So Fergie had to stay home with his brother Freddy and all his froggy friends went to camp. So Fergie took off. That night, as Fergie lay in bed, he decided to run away. I'll change my name and join another family where I count more than math does, he muttered to himself. At midnight, Fergie climbed out of his mud hole and packed 3 peanut butter and spider leg sandwiches, 5 cockroach cookies, and 2 cans of Slimeade. But he put his favorite Super Frog comic book into his pack and hopped off to start a new life. As Fergie hopped along, he picked a new name. Frank, he thought. Just the name for a frog seeking adventure. He sang a little rhyme about his new life to keep the dark away. Frankly, I'm Frank the Frog. I live in a hollow log. I'll be a great swimmer, and I'll catch flies for dinner, then bask in the sun in the bog. As he hummed his song, Fergie, who was now Frank, headed into a part of the forest he'd never explored before. As the sun rose, he ate a sandwich and drank 1 can of Slimeade. This is the life, he thought. No time stables. He began to look for a hollow log, but all he could find was an old stump, which he had to share with a woodpecker. He ate another sandwich and 2 cookies for lunch. He swam in the stream that afternoon, but it wasn't much fun without his friends. I'd better catch some flies for dinner, he thought. So Frank, jumped on the stump and waited for some flies. He waited and waited. A butterfly flitted by. He shot out his tongue and missed. Oh well, he thought, I wouldn't want to eat a butterfly anyway. Maybe I can find some mosquitoes by the stream. Frank hopped back to the stream and caught a couple of mosquitoes. He was still hungry, so he ate his last sandwich and 2 more cookies for supper. As he finished his last can of Slimeade, he thought, maybe tomorrow will be a better day. He couldn't remember his way back to the stump, so he curled up under a toadstool to sleep. He sang his little rhyme as the sun set. Frankly, I'm Frank the Frog. I live in a hollow log. That night, he heard every creak in the forest. When an owl hooted, he trembled and said, who's there? Hoo-hoo, the owl answered. It's Froggy here. I mean Frank, he whispered. Please don't eat me. By morning, Frank the Frog felt pretty miserable. I had only 1 cockroach cookie left. I wonder what Mom and Dad are having for breakfast. I wonder if they miss me. Some raindrops fell on Fergie's nose, mixing in with some teardrops. I wish Frank the Frog had a friend or a brother like Freddy, Fergie thought. He sang his song again, and he sniffed away his tears. Frankly, I'm Frank the Frog. Frank, called a familiar voice. Frank, is that you? I thought I heard someone singing a little song. Dad, answered Fergie. Is that you, Dad? A second later, Father Frog hopped through the grass. Here you are. We've been looking for you all day and all night. His father chuckled. Of course, we were looking for Fergie, not Frank. Fergie started to cry. I'm Fergie. I'm not Frank anymore. I want to come home. I've even done my times tables if you let me come home. Fergie, having you back home is what counts. Maybe you and I can do the math together. Here, I brought a caterpillar and cream cheese sandwich just in case you were hungry. Fergie munched his breakfast happily. Frankie, Dad, he said, I'm very glad you came. Yeah, so he was thankful. He was thankful for the love of his dad. What are you all thinking about? Loving God, thank you for all the wonderful blessings you've given us. We're grateful for our family, friends, and the love we share. Every perfect, good, and perfect gift is from above. Help us always remember to say thank you and to be kind and grateful in everything we do. In Jesus' name. Good to see each and every one of you.
Thank you.
prayer of illumination. God of wisdom, send us your spirit to open our minds to your word. Move our hearts to deeper love and our wills to greater service through Jesus Christ, your word made flesh. Amen.
Our first reading this morning is from the book of the prophet Joel, chapter 2. Do not fear, O soil. Be glad and rejoice, for the Lord has done great things. Do not fear, you animals of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness are green. The tree bears its fruit. The fig tree and vine give their full yield. O children of Zion, be glad and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given the early rain for your vindication. He has poured down for you abundant rain, the early and the later rain, as before. The threshing floors shall be full of grain. The vats shall overflow with wine and oil. I will repay you for the years that the swarming locust has eaten, the hopper, the destroyer, and the cutter, my great army that I sent against you. You shall eat in plenty and be satisfied and praise the name of the Lord your God, who has dealt wondrously with you. And my people shall never again be put to shame. You shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I, the Lord, am your God, and there is no other, and my people shall never again be put to shame. Our psalm we will read responsibly, so please stand as you are able. When the Lord restored the fortunes of Zion, we were like those who dream.
Then our mouth was filled with laughter, and our tongue with shouts of joy. Then it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for him.
The Lord has done great things for us, and we rejoiced.
Restore our fortunes, O Lord, like the water courses in the Negev.
May those who sow in tears reap with shouts of joy.
Those who go out weeping, bearing the seed for sowing, shall come home with shouts of joy, carrying their sheaves.
Please be seated. Our reading from the New Testament is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6. Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear. Is not life more than food, and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? And which of you by worrying can add a single hour to your span of life? And why do you worry about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Therefore, do not worry, saying, what will we eat, or what will we drink, or what will we wear? For it is the Gentiles who seek after all these things, and indeed, your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gratitude is the theme of this beautiful fall day here in the valley. I'm sure you'll agree with me that we have so much to be grateful for. Here we are celebrating Thanksgiving. So many blessings. But are we as thankful as often and as fully as we might be? I believe our personal cultivating of gratitude will prove critical to successfully navigating the challenging days that lie ahead. However, what do we with our gratitude? However, what do we do with our gratitude ultimately may be as important as feeling it. As I picked up a few things at the local farmers market on Friday, I was awestruck at the mind-blowing abundance of the fresh vegetables and fruit this valley produces. The colors, the aromas, the textures, I could not help but reconnect in my heart with so many people, culinary events, and memories in my life that revolved around food and hospitality. For me, these were moments of deep thanksgiving and examples of how God always provides exactly the best of what we need. I was also amazed at the crowd. The shopping had the same atmosphere as Christmas Eve, including the quest for the perfect turkey. The produce, the vineyards, the food, the pumpkins, the turkeys. I can see why so many people head to the valley as part of their Thanksgiving tradition. That day, I'm sure shoppers were grateful for all of creation's grand and colorful abundance in the sight before them. Undoubtedly, each of them was thankful for the blessings they encountered this year. But is there more lingering under the surface? I also wondered what else is in our hearts and minds as we come together collectively to celebrate Thanksgiving 2024. Let's go one layer deeper. Let's be honest. Being thankful in this challenging world can be hard. What might Thanksgiving offer us this year? Right now, for so many of us, and for so many different reasons, we can't seem to enjoy Thanksgiving and our abundance deeply. Maybe our desire for thankfulness is fleeting and thin, shooed away by conditions such as food insecurity, physical health challenges, the struggles and suffering of both those near and far from us, the cost of housing, our daily struggles to keep our mental well-being on an even keel. Maybe it's our faith that slides away when we're confronted with discomforting times. If that's you today, it's okay. Welcome those feelings in. They matter, and you matter. Let's look again at today's Hebrew scripture, to Joel's words of hope. The prophet's brave words were first spoken to a people in extreme adversity and exile. Ones who were sad, shocked, and heart-sickened from their horrible experience of exile, forced from their home into the land of foreign oppressors. The Israelites had lost everything and all they had ever known. And yet God spoke profound words of promise and hope to these exiles. Do not fear, Joel the prophet told them. Be glad and rejoice, for the Lord has done great things. Joel reminded the ancient chosen one of God's steadfast love, of the infinite blessings God has always provided. Today, in this time and place, Joel's profound words remind us too to be glad and to rejoice, and to give thanks. Let us pray. Loving God of ever-evolving diversity and life, made known in seed, soil, and the wonders of human creation, may your word for us today free our hearts from anxiety and open them to learn from the life that surrounds us, as we pray through Jesus Christ, the Lord of all harvests. Amen. I deeply believe the challenge of successfully navigating the days that lie before us is really going to come down to thanksgiving, down to living out the constant practice of gratitude. And this is where our gospel reading this morning from Matthew picks up. Jesus seems to speak directly to our situation in the Sermon on the Mount, as much as he spoke to his first century followers. Do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, but strive first for the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you. As we watch our daily news feeds with waves of fear and winds of panic sweeping over our collective souls, it's easy to identify with the disciples. What could possibly be thrown at us next? There they were, the first followers of Jesus, straining at their oars, being battered by the wind and waves of their lives in trying to follow Jesus Christ. Scared, even angry, because they didn't know where Jesus was in a frightening moment when they really needed him. What comfort we find in Jesus' words of greeting as he came walking on the water towards them, unshaken by the storm. Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid. Our faith, especially when it's challenged, can sometimes become like so many things in our lives. We forget to trust it. Instead of picking it up and using it as our first go-to emotion, we ignore faith's hope and promise in our one steadfast, loving God. Instead, we very quickly leap to embody the disciples' anger over why Jesus is not here. Why is this happening to us? Like our lives, our faith is sometimes tired and worn out. Our emotional system loves bright, shiny, new ideas, and we quickly adapt to what we already have been given. The new car, the great job, the new relationship, the new house. But very quickly, these quick fixes that make us feel good for a moment don't seem so new and exciting anymore. Why are we Christians so quick to forget the blessings we've been given? Remind yourself. As Joel reminded the Israelites, today I invite you to take some time to remember and reimagining the blessings, both big and small, you've received this week, this past year, even decades ago, a lifetime ago. Were you grateful? What did that feel like? Do you remember the things you prayed for and were given? The times and events you thought you would never get through, and yet you did? Make this a habit. A deep sense of gratitude and thanksgiving is so important. It allows us to engage more in our lives, no matter what that life looks like. If we thankfully and boldly declare that our loving God is with us in all things, we start to embody and live out this truth. Living in gratitude stops the unhealthy transmission of pain and suffering into the world. Notice the positive more, and that will surely magnify our gratitude. Thanksgiving as a lifestyle helps us navigate our negative emotions, work through our own pain, and better understand what fuels the wrong actions and poor behaviors of those around us. Trust me, I get it. It seems like almost impossible work, but gratitude sets us up to be compassionate helpers and healings of other beings who suffer. It's simple. God loves us and provides us all we need. We acknowledge every blessing received and are humbly thankful for every gift. We praise God every moment. Our belief and our faith grows and strengthens, and that's the cycle of gratitude. Scripture tells us, look at the birds of the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they? Brené Brown defines gratitude as the emotion that most reflects our deep appreciation for what we value, what brings meaning to our lives, and what makes us feel connected to ourselves and others. However, she reminds the reader that gratitude is also a practice. Like our faith, gratitude is cultivated best by doing, trying, failing, and trying again, and maybe even failing again. But that's okay. As we begin to earnestly face the consequences of this struggling world and reflect upon the political and economic forces that have led to our current state, we find comfort and truth in Jesus' words. One's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions, Luke 12. Our world needs a gospel message of thanksgiving today. It is a call to hope in a loving God who will not abandon us, and call to repent before a God who forgives and heals us. Ultimately, thanksgiving is an invitation, a credo, a call to believe, to trust, and to be deeply grateful. May the truth of these words guide us all to a different future, as we are assured of the love of our steadfast God, Jesus, our Savior. Thanksgiving is not about giving thanks for what we have received, but it's also about what we do with it. I wish you a blessed Thanksgiving. May we live and share as the thankful people of God.
Let us pray. Kind and generous God, as we give thanks for the harvest, we pause to praise you for all those things, both great and small, which fill our lives with meaning and offer us a sense of well-being. May your spirit, O God, may our friends see in us signs of a grateful heart. Merciful and generous God, as we give thanks for the harvest of the earth, show us how to live respectfully in creation and protect all that is precious to you. In a year when harvests vary across our country, show us how to share what has been produced so that no one goes hungry. By your Spirit, O God, may our friends see in us signs of a grateful heart. Just and generous God, we pray for the well-being of your world in our own community. Where there is hostility between nations or neighbors, inspire leaders to show wisdom and courage in decision-making. We pray for areas hard hit by flood, storm, fire, or earthquake, and for all those struggling in an uncertain economy. May neighbors with resources maintain generosity and compassion for the long work of reconstructing lives and livelihoods. By your Spirit, O God, may our friends see in us signs of a grateful heart. Healing and generous God, we pray for those facing health challenges or difficult times for any reason, and we pray for family and friends under stress or in sorrow whom we name in silence before you. Give us patience and understanding as we draw near to them, and help us to reach out with compassion. By your Spirit, O God, may our friends see in us signs of a grateful heart. O God, in Jesus Christ, we have found your generous love and mercy. Through our lives and by our prayers, reveal his love and mercy in this generation, for it is in his name we offer this prayer. Amen.
At Thanksgiving, we celebrate the gifts of God's good earth which sustains us. Yet this year we know in some places harvest will not be plentiful. In every community, neighbors struggle to make ends meet. Today we offer what we have to share in gratitude, praying our gifts will make a difference in the difficult times, trusting that God goes with us, whatever we face. Our morning offering will now begin. Gracious God, we offer you our thanks for all the goodness we enjoy in Christ and in creation. Bless these gifts we bring and use them to relieve the needs and anxiety many feel these days. May anxious lives see signs of your love and joy in what we can offer them. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our friend. Amen. Dear friends, cherish each day as God's gift, so that you may with a wise heart live with gratitude from all God's goodness. So may God who made you, the Christ who mends you, and the Spirit who brings you life, bless and keep you now and always.